All right. Okay. So now, here we go. Tonight's testimony will be from Elizabeth Bigouette.
My name, my given name is Elizabeth, but please don't call me that. Only my mom calls me that, and only Robert when he's trying to push my buttons. I'm Liz, okay? If I seem nervous, you have to forgive me. I just have a hard time speaking in front of people. So I just want to start by saying I was born and raised in South Texas. As any good Southern girl, I grew up believing in God, but not knowing him. I grew up in trailer parks, so yeah, trailer park trash. Proud to say it. And as a child, I witnessed and experienced many things that no kid should ever experience. You know, I witnessed there were drugs all around, there was violence, there was abuse, and many other things. But I just want to say, I don't hold anything from my childhood against my mom. I love her dearly, and I know that she did the best that she knew how. And I can in no way blame any of my actions or choices on my past. Today is now, and tomorrow is a new day, and it has nothing to do with my past. So as a teen, I was allowed to pretty much do whatever I wanted with very little consequences. And at the same time, I had this deep-seated feeling that I didn't want my life to be the same that my mother had. Being married at a young, you know, at a young age, having kids young, and then being a single mom and struggling and seeing the loneliness and sadness and the struggle that she constantly had. And so because of this, I had promised myself I was not getting married until I was 30, and I was not having kids unless I adopted them, and I was going to have a career. So many of you know that that didn't happen. So even after making that promise, though, I continued to make decisions that were taking me down that same road that I didn't want to be on. And one evening, I found myself about to do something that was probably a step above and beyond what I had been doing. But before I could, I heard a voice as if someone had been sitting next to me say, "If you do this, you will go down that same road as your mother." And it's like, that's one of those memories that's in my head as if it was yesterday, and I could just hear that voice so clearly in my head. Looking back, I know that that was the Lord protecting me, because he had something better for me. I walked away that night, but I still was not saved and continued to sin. So about 6 months after this, and not long after I had promised myself I wasn't going to get married till I was 30, I met Robert. And we were married shortly after and had a baby and another baby, another baby, another baby. So we have 4 kids. So we fell in love and got married. We have 4 kids within 5 years. But it was not all a bed of roses, though, as neither of us was saved, which meant that we were both selfish and focused on worldly things, and there were issues, and I had even reached a point where I was not happy with the way things were going and was considering taking the kids to go live with my mom and just let Robert do what he needed to do, which, looking back, I would, by doing that, by going out and being a single mom and struggling on my own, would have been going down that same road again that I was within myself not wanting to do. But praise the Lord, miracles do happen. After our third child, the Lord placed someone in our lives to witness to Robert. He then got saved, and through witnessing what happened in his life, I then got saved probably about 6 months after him. So then we were no longer looking at our circumstances, but at the Lord. And because of the Lord being in the midst of our marriage, this September we'll be married 27 years. So now I just want to point out a few of the things that that the Lord did through all of this. in Jeremiah 1:5, he says, I knew you before I formed you in your mother's womb. Before you were born, I set you apart and appointed you as my prophet to the nations. Now, he didn't make me a prophet like he did Jeremiah, but he did know me before I was even created, and I believe he has a plan for my life. In Psalm 138:8, the Lord will work out his plans for my life, for your faithful love, O Lord, endures forever. Don't abandon me, for you made me. And in Romans 5:8, but God demonstrates his own love toward us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Even while I was in the midst of my sin, he called out to me. I didn't know him, and at that time when I heard that voice, I didn't know what it was, but now looking back, I can see that that was the Lord intervening in my life. In Matthew 7:13 through 14, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. That wide gate to hell is easy to find, and I kept finding myself heading towards it, towards destruction. But God, the path to life may be narrow and difficult, but he promises to never leave us nor forsake us. In Deuteronomy 31:6, and in Psalm chapter 119, verse 105, his word is a light to our path. So even on that narrow, hard path, he's never going to leave you nor forsake you, and his word will light your way on that path. So life is still difficult and full of choices, but now I know that he is a good God, and a this life here on earth is not all there is.
Okay. If everyone could begin to get back to your seats, if we could have some of the guys close the side doors, and then I'm going to go shut these lights off. Give me just a moment. Actually, Michael can shut the lights off. That's it, dinner and movie. Yes, all of them. All right. As you know, when we come together, one of the things that we do in communion is we come together not just to, we're not here just to perform an act of communion. That's not what we're here to do. We are here to remember Jesus Christ and him crucified. This is one of the things that the scripture actually tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26. It says, as often as we do this, as we eat this bread, as we drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And when we proclaim the crucifixion, when we proclaim the cross, we proclaim him rising from the dead. In the cross is wrapped up everything. It's our salvation. It's the atonement for our sins. It's the appropriation for us. It is everything. And also in it is the resurrection from the dead. In his resurrection, we know that we will have life and we will be raised from the dead. So the communion that we are about to partake of together is not a small thing. And for those of you that are unfamiliar with what we do, we have the elements on the table. In a moment, we're going to begin a song. When that song begins, the oldest male at the table will begin to pour the cup for everyone else at the table. You can take your own bread from the center. And what this is signifying, it is signifying that all of us are partaking of this together. That each and every person that you are sitting at the table with, when you're looking at someone across from you, that's why we have the round tables, you're looking at someone that Christ died for. And you're communing with them as much as we are communing with him at this very moment. So these are elements that represent who he is. The cup being his blood. The bread being his body. But it's just representative. It's not his actual body. It's not his actual blood. And we'll go into that as we go. So when you get your bread and you get your cup, hold on to it, and then I'll tell you when to take it, and we'll all take it together at the same time. But for now, as the worship begins, once you have your bread and your cup, then just sing to the Lord. You can look at the lyrics on the back, or if you're facing this way, you can see the lyrics on the front. So let's go ahead and begin to worship and go ahead and begin to do the elements. First Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. Paul. I'm so blown away because just imagine hearing this from Christ, talking about how on the same night that Judas betrayed me, we took bread. And Paul says, and when he had given thanks, so Jesus had given thanks, and he broke it, and he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Pray with me if you would. Father, as we come to you, Lord, remembering the sacrifice, the suffering, Father, the suffering that was not due to you. You were not guilty, Lord. You had no sin. But Lord, you were doing it for us. You were taking our sin upon you. You were paying the price for what we have done. Lord God, we thank you for this. We thank you, Lord. Let's partake of the bread. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Pray with me if you would. Father, we thank you so much for this new covenant that you have made with all of humanity, Lord, that you have given yourself for us, that you have done this, Lord, and that our salvation is not in anything that we do, Father. The only thing you call us to do, the only work you say in the book of John, is to believe in you. That is it, Lord. As we repent from our sins, as we turn from those lives that we lived, and we trust you alone for our salvation, you give it. And this is the covenant that you have written, and you rose again from the dead to show it. Let's partake of the cup. Lord, we remember the sacrifice that you have made in this. We remember what you have done for us in this. Father, we celebrate it, Lord, not just the cross, and we do celebrate in that cross because it paid for me, Lord. It prayed for them. It paid for all of us. But Father, we also celebrate because of your resurrection from the dead, that you did not stay down. And Lord, we now have your life, your new life living within us. And if there's anyone here tonight, Lord, who is unsure if they truly know you, who is not sure, absolutely sure that they know you, Lord, I pray that tonight that they would meet you, that they would repent of their sins, that they would turn from them, Lord, and trust you alone for their salvation in the work that you have done. I thank you, Father, that you have done this, and you have done it in us through the love, the grace, and the mercy of Jesus Christ and his sacrifice on the cross. And we just pray these things and we lift them up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would, you can rise from your seats if you like. If you want to sit in the seat, if you want to kneel, however you want to worship, you worship. I'm going to be in the back if anyone needs prayer.
So teach my song to rise to you.
Yes, Lord, we just, Father, we thank you so much for bringing us here tonight, Lord, for allowing us to take part in this communion, Lord, and and thank you even more so, Lord, just for what it means, for the salvation that you've given us, Father God. We thank you so much. We praise you, Lord. We want to give you all of our worship, all of our praise, all the glory, Lord, and we just give it all to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Just as a shout out to you guys, the refrigerator that a family needed was found, provided for, and delivered. So praise the Lord for that, right? There is someone in the fellowship who needs a full-size bed frame. They've only got a mattress, so it needs to be one of those bed frames that, like, has support built into it, or a frame and a box spring. But full-size bed frame. So put that out to you if you know of anything or you know where anything might be. Let us know. Let's see. Secondly, I like you guys. If I could get, could you come up, Marco? Yeah. Turn the teaching light on, Mike. Everybody, I would like to introduce you to Marco Munoz, the new U-Turn director. All right. So this is the guy we're looking to. This is the guy that, you know, God's going to use, just like he's been using you guys. And, you know, lift him up in your prayers. He's going to need it, right? Thank you, Martin. Marco. So I know I'm going to be calling him Martin. Marcos. My apologies. I forget my own kids' names, so yes. I really do. Huh? What? I know, yeah. I don't get your name right. And I destroy your dreams. Right? Anyway, if you've got time, I know some of you have to go, but if you've got time and you'd like to stay and help clean up, you're more than welcome. You know, and if you've got to go, get... will be U-Turn service Friday evening, and I believe there's a special guest teacher. And then Sunday, we're into the book of Acts, and we'll be looking at Acts chapter 2, looking at the coming of the Holy Spirit upon the church. And then next Wednesday, we'll be back into Exodus. So God bless you guys. Huh? Oh, yeah, and then we have Youth Sunday. So...